Hello boys and girls. In this video I will for once not do any coding. I will just prove a version of Lawvere's fixed point theorem, which is a generalization of the diagonal construction that Georg Cantor first employed to, for example, show the uncountability of the continuum, and which has translations to diagonal arguments by Gödel and so on and so forth. So just for the context, so you know, there's this the diagonal argument from 150 years ago, which shows that you can't put the natural numbers and the real numbers or the continuum or the power set of the natural numbers in bijection. And so the set theoretic version, which I'm going to discuss in a future video in more detail, goes by Cantor's theorem. You show that there is no bijection between natural numbers and the power set of the natural numbers, and that this actually extends to any set. So for any cardinal, the 2 to this cardinal, the power operation is bigger. I'm going to be very explicit about that one in the future, but in this video I will step through a version that is not really relying on set theory so much. We're just going to talk about functions and do some constructions. It is pretty straightforward and also pretty clear how we plug together the functions, and in that sense rewarding, that you can see how that might be used for different no-go arguments. So I will not go through the this paper here at all. It's like a category theoretical paper, and this is the general context in which this is proven. Our context will be slightly smaller, but the general argument will translate to these situations as well. Then there's another paper that I want to point out, which is a good read and a little bit longer, extending on the ideas in this short paper or re-implementing them. And then on the NLAB, there's one page for Cantor's theorem and a version for posets that's in this book by Taylor called Practical Foundations for Mathematics, if I recall it correctly. And then there's the fixed point theorem. This is the one we will step through. Here it is actually in the category theoretical setting, of course. And then I also want to point out that there is Bauer and Escardo, who both sometimes blog on the Mathematics for Computer site. And here also has one quite short article on the theorem we are proving today, and pretty much the same version as well. Okay, yeah, and that this is here, I think, an actor implementation of a version of that. Okay, but without further ado, let me step through the proof here. So for the sake of not taking too long, I've already written everything down. I will just step through it. I could also, you know, write it down on the fly, as I usually do it with the code. But for the sake of having a short video, maybe I can stick under 15 minutes. So let me try that format. You can also comment if that works or not. I've also chosen to do it in a text editor instead of compiling everything to a LaTeX file, so that I can actually maybe type here if I want to, if something comes to mind while I do my rant. Okay, so let's do it. It's really like very straightforward. The theorem is basically this version of the theorem where we use not, you know, it's not so error theoretic. We choose a setting where we basically say all objects are types and all the errors are functions. It is proven, quotes and quotes, in a line. So, okay, we will deal with two types, X and V. You can also consider them sets. And then we have two functions with the following types. So n goes from v to v, and the function f goes from x to the function space from x to v. So this could also be written like so. And in fact, I write it like that because in the category theoretic version, you have this the object that's basically a function space. And so we might think of all the functions from x to v, but this will hold also if you restrict the function space. Like say you restrict yourself to all the continuous functions or whatever this is. So I could also write functions from x to v. But for the sake of it, think of it for now as just plainly the functions from x to v, right? So this, if these are just the functions, then this could also be written as like so. So we are occurring, this is f is a function that takes two values of x and returns a v, right? In any case, the point will be that eventually this will, the theorem that we will see in a second will generally hold. And then we are going to consider some special cases. And in particular, how this comes back to Cantor's theorem is by considering eventually the logical truth values as v. So in the normal Boolean case, this will be yes or no, true or false, and n will be the negation. That's why it's called n, right? But again, this holds for any v that goes from v to v, n that goes from v to v. Okay, so we define now another function that sits in this function space by this construction. So this is the fd, because this is basically the diagonal construction, right? So if you go back to the f is such that you can basically plug in values of x twice, right? If you plug in some value in x, then you get some function, and the function is also from x to v, right? So what you can do is, given any x, you apply x, like you apply the function to x, and whatever function comes out of it that is in the space, you apply it to x again. So this will be a value in v, and now we can apply n to it, and we've forwarded between values in v, right? So this is just the general definition. And now the theorem is basically the following observation. If there exists a value in x, let's call it d, such that f of d, so this is a some function here, is actually this function that we have just defined, right? This function is here if f actually for some d sees this function, if f sees this function, then what happens? Well, if you plug in the value d here, let's actually do this. So if this value, if it exists, that has this property, if you plug it in here, then by assumption, so if this exists such that this holds, then f of d is just this, right? And then what we see here is that if we give this another name, let's say v0, or I called it vd here, if you define this value as that, right, then the result of on this the result of applying that translates to this expression, and this just says that VD is actually a fixed point of the function n, right? VD that we have constructed like that, if this assumption holds, becomes a value such that if you plug it into to n, then the same value comes out again. So this is a fixed point, right? So the theorem says, if there is a D such that F sees FD, then the same value D makes for a fixed point of n, where the fixed point value is just this. Okay, you can think about it for a second, but basically this is already the theorem. It says that if you have any function that forwards a v value, and if you have any function that that basically encodes functions from x to v with x values, then you can define this so-called, you know, diagonal function or whatnot, such that if there's a special relation, if f actually sees this special function, then by construction we've just shown that there is a fixed point then. Okay, and this has now some consequences. Okay, firstly, let me comment on these special cases here. If the n is a trivial function, like if this function you choose there is not interesting, then the theorem is also not interesting. In particular, if n is the identity, you know, for the identity, every value is a fixed point. So this is then always true, and so there's nothing to gain here. Then this will always be true anyway. And similarly, if n is a constant function, right, if n is a constant function, then fd is also just a constant function. So there is also nothing to be gained here. Okay, and when v is a singleton, then that means n is the constant function by definition, because there's only one constant function it can map, only one value it can map to, so n becomes a constant function. Okay, this is not an interesting case. And the joke about this theorem is that if this is the boring case where v is a singleton, if now v is a set and not a singleton, then the thing is then that the right hand side of the theorem is never true, and basically the theorem is trivial, but it still holds. And if we then consider the contraposition, then we get the no-go result that is Cantor's theorem. We will see that in a second. Okay, so let's actually step down a little bit and look at even more special cases from that. So okay, we start here again. Now this theorem is very explicit. It tells me what the fixed point is if it exists. In the step three, I just weaken it, as I just forget about what the fixed point is and say, well, if this holds, so this is the same assumption here, then there exists a fixed point. And if this is a non-constructive quantifier, then that means I threw away information here. Okay, so this is a weaker version of the theorem, right? The theorem is actually quite constructive. Then even weaker, so if f is surjective, right? If f actually sees all values, then in particular it will see fd, because fd is some value in the function space, right? So if f is surjective, then this automatically holds, and then this implies, as we have shown, that n has a fixed point, right? So this is also a version already quite weakened, but it's still interesting, right? If you have this surjective function that enumerates functions in this function space, then we know that any function n has a fixed point, if this is possible that this function is surjective, right? Okay, and now for the contrapositive of this statement here. So if there is no fixed point, like if it would be absurd if there was a fixed point, well, then it means that the function can also not see fd, right? Because if there was no fixed point and the function would see fd, then there was a fixed point as well as no fixed point, and that would be a contradiction. So this is just making the contraposition of the version 3 here, and we see, so no fixed point means also our constructed diagonal function cannot be seen. This is already the kind of the gist from Cantor's theorem, right? And then again, stating this, the right hand version even weaker. So if there is no fixed point, then in particular f can also not be surjective, right? So again, this sounds already still much like Cantor's theorem, but the fun fact is that we have not even specified anything about this space V or N. This holds in general. This is quite interesting. Okay, and now let's narrow it down a little bit. So we had already the case where V was just a singleton. Now let's consider the case where V is indeed a set, and also a set with just two elements. So basically the set of Boolean values, say yes, no, 0, 1, true, false. And then there are not so many possibilities for n. Either, you know, n is now a function from the bools to the bools. Either n is the identity, we have already covered it, or n just points at one of the truth values, we have already covered it. So the only option that is left is when n is actually the negation, when n flips true to false and false to true. In which case, if it flips the values around, then obviously this function has no fixed point, right? No value, no truth value, if you negate it, is the value itself. So in this case, if we say that n is the negation on booleans, then it is actually the case that there is no fixed point for n, which means that d cannot be found by the function f. Fd cannot be found by the function f. And so if you write it down, and that, of course, you know, this holds also for all f's and n, and we have specified n. So for all functions x to 2 to the power of x, there is no value such that this function that maps x to the negation of f of x, right? This is just this where I put a negation in explicitly, and also lambda abstracted the x. So this is just the function fd for this special case. This function can never be found in the case that x maps to boo to the power of x. Okay. And now, interestingly, we can also do this for other truth values, like other logics if you want. We can not only consider the case where we have yes or no, but we can also speak about other truth values, and there will also be a negation on this space where this logic topoi, if you want. And André Bauer quickly mentions that, but he only has two paragraphs on that. But he mentions some examples where this might be interesting. But I will not cover that in any detail here. And that already basically makes our examples of types for this theorem. Spoiler for the version that I will discuss in a future video. We already talked about characteristic functions on X, right? So functions that map to the bools, and you can easily translate characteristic functions to subsets, right? You say, if the characteristic function agrees, yes, then this element is in a subset, if not, then not. And so we can translate the previous version to a subset version, right? Where when previously we had some characteristic function S on bool to X, then this would correspond to this subset where the S of X agrees. And these, the whole collection of all the subsets of X, this is of course the power set of X, right? So if you translate this directly, then it says for all functions that map into the power set, there is no value such that f sees this fd, right? And this will translate in the proof that I'll show in a future video to this function. So all the x such that x is not in f of x, right? And this is Cantor's theorem, right? This is then literally Cantor's theorem. And so in particular, this means there is some function that will not be seen by f, and so f can never be surjective. Right, so this is the weaker version then. And so we have then seen that we cannot have a surjection into the power set. So this is then a set such that there's no surjection, and there is also an easy injection from each set to the power set, right? You map every value to the singleton. And so we have shown that there is an injection but no surjection, and then together in classical logic, that means that the power set of X is always bigger than the set. It's a little bit more difficult in constructive logics, how you define these negative statements with, oh, there is no surjection and therefore blah blah blah. So this is a little bit more complicated in the non-classical logics, where negation is treated a little bit more intricately. But yeah, so this is basically it. I didn't stick it under 15 minutes, but I think it was, I really like that one because it's like so explicit till the whole construction of this FD and so on and so forth, right? Hope you liked it, and wish you a pleasant night.